For longtime visitors to the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness, Dorothy Molter was one of the finest people they'd ever meet. Dorothy represented one of the last links to a lifestyle that, if it isn't gone already, may soon disappear. While thousands called on Dorothy's island in the BWCA, only a handful of people could be called close friends. Among them was Bob Cary, newspaper editor and columnist, and most recently, the author of a book detailing the life of a Dorothy Molter only a few ever knew. Bob recently sat down with us to chat about the woman many only knew as the Root Beer Lady.
There's some mavericks in our civilization just don't fit the mold. They have an idea or a dream or something, and they just follow it.
Dorothy Molter may have been a maverick following her dreams, but she was a kind-hearted and gracious maverick. In fact, Bob Cary says she may be the only person he ever knew that had no enemies. A little background for those of you who aren't familiar with the story of Dorothy Molter. She first came to the North Country in 1930, a young nurse from Chicago, looking to live her life as few others have before or since. She moved into several cabins on Isle of Pines in Knife Lake, one of the thousands of bodies of water that would eventually become part of the Boundary Waters Canoe Area. Dorothy lived an uncomplicated life, taking what she needed from the land and little else, nursing sick and injured campers when they needed aid, and making root beer on her island to quench the thirst of summer visitors. For Bob Cary, it made choosing a title for his book simple, since many of Dorothy's guests knew her simply as the Root Beer Lady.
I knew Dorothy for over 30 years, and for 20 years we talked about doing the book, and kept a few notes and bits and pieces and photos and things, and she always said when she was ready for the rocking chair, we'd do the book. And of course, she never got to the rocking chair.
Over the years, a number of stories and legends surrounding Dorothy have sprung up, and one reason Bob wrote his book was to set the record straight. Perhaps the biggest myth about Dorothy Molter was that she was the lonely woman living in the wilds of northern Minnesota. The truth was, Dorothy might have had more company than anyone in the state.
Now that started with a writer for Saturday Evening Post, who came up there at a period of time when there wasn't anybody there. And so he wrote this great story, not realizing that there were between 6,000 and 7,000 people that signed her guest book every year. And that started the avalanche of media people up there, all looking for this loneliest woman in the world. And of course she wasn't, but they wrote it that way. And it got to be pretty funny. It was a local joke up there, you know, about the loneliest woman. She had more friends than any woman in the country.
And she got a pretty good kick out of it.
She sure did. And not only that, in later years, she became more famous. Then she began to feed them stories.
Such as?
Oh, she'd tell them things that she thought maybe they'd want to hear. She'd embellish some of the stories. You know, it was if it was a case where she met with a bear, well, maybe this was a thing where the bear was after her. And she just, you know, usually she was very close to the truth, but sometimes she'd get a, you know, just a little glint in her eye and start things going. And
that's not to say that a few incredible tales were very much true. In fact, Bob was with Dorothy for one of her finest hours.
Probably the greatest story, one of the greatest stories that's been kicked around about her, I was involved in, and that involved one of the portages. When she came down and got supplies quite a few times, I would give her a ride in my big boat. I had a rack on top, put a canoe on. I'd give her a ride in her canoe and her four packs or five packs up to the first portage, which was 14 miles up. So I'd give her a good leg up on the way back. And she had only that portage and four more to make to get back to her camp. This one story, I got up there with her one day, and it was a nice, warm July day, and we unloaded the canoe, the packs, the motor, the works. And just as we got unloaded, there was two young guys, about 25, came across going the other way. One with a canoe, one with a pack. huffing and puffing and put the pack down, put the canoe down, and took a look at her and said, you going the other way? And she said, yes. And they said, well, we've got to go back across for another load. Could we give you a hand with your stuff, mother? Well, she froze. You know, she stiffened in, and she looked at me with a little glint in her eye, and she walked over and threw a 60-pound pack up in the back and another 60-pound pack in the front, threw up a 93-pound canoe, picked up the motor and said, you two kids get those other two packs. It would sure help a lot. And it just paralyzed them. And, I mean, this was standard for her. And then they looked at me and, go ahead. I don't know if they ever knew who they met. She had so many pets. She had pet crows, pet deer, pet beaver at the dock, and she had several pet mink at one time or another. She had one called Slinky that rode around on her shoulders. When it got tired of riding her shoulders, he used to crawl down the side of her shirt and curl up down here. Well, we never thought anything about it, but sometimes she'd be in the kitchen drinking coffee with some tourists, you know, and they'd be talking. All of a sudden, Slinky would wake up and come out between the second and third button, you know, and bah! Yeah, all that kind of stuff.
As Dorothy became older and access to her cabin became more difficult because of changes in laws, she had to depend on her friends in Ely and elsewhere for support. Although no one wants to admit they might need the help of others, Dorothy was a courteous recipient of the aid from those who saw her as someone to be respected and loved.
She was very gracious, accepting help from people, and in turn she put forth a lot of hospitality. Anytime you came to her place, it didn't make any difference. The coffee pot was always on the barrel stove, and there was a great big dishpan full of oatmeal cookies, always, you know. And very hospitable person.
Dorothy passed away on the Isle of Pines in Knife Lake in December of 1986. She never retired to that rocking chair so Bob could write his book, but now it's finally complete. Bob Cary has set the record straight, and Dorothy Molter will continue to live on in thoughts and memories.
Every once in a while we get together, you know, and you're drinking coffee with some of the old-timers and some of the people that were younger than her. And we were drinking coffee one day, and somebody said, gee, you know, it's just too bad Dorothy's gone. We sure miss Dorothy. And one of the old guys said, I'm going to tell you something, kid. If you go by there in one of those autumn days, you know, when the trees are turning gold and the sun's just barely coming up and the mist is coming off the water, if you look real close over that island, you'll see an old bent figure over there with a bucket in one hand. Come on over and have some coffee. She's still there. She's still there. Yeah, we know it. The old timers know it.
That'll wrap it up for this week's show. For Melissa Oden, John Tremec, Tom Cornell, Ron Flesvig, and the rest of our Venture North team, I'm Roy Flynn. We'll see you again next week.